Hi, and welcome to the 93rd TiddlyWiki Hangout. I'm Jeremy Ruston, the inventor of TiddlyWiki, and today I'm delighted to be joined from left to right on my screen by Alex. Alex, would you like to say hello, introduce yourself, tell everybody where you're from, and very briefly about your involvement with TiddlyWiki?
I'm Alex Huff, north of England, well, near Manchester. And been involved in TiddlyWiki. There's the feedback, is it? No, it's not a feedback. I'm really interested from the last hangout about this talk about the hypertext and things like that. So I've come to TiddlyWiki, well, and stuff like this via hypertext first. So When I was an art student, I did a lot of, in visual arts, you talk about hypertext and weird lectures and things. And so, the last hangout was just fascinating for me because they had Carlos talking about discourse analysis. And anyway, hypertext and discourse analysis was basically a lot of my degree. So, it feels like it's coming, TiddlyWiki sort of coming around to where I sort of picked it up, which was just after my degree when I got out into real world computers, you know, behind the firewall, and found TiddlyWiki, and stuff around hypertext writing, which I did a bit of, and hypertext in visual art.
So, I think one of the things that wishing to monopolize the discussion, I mean, the introduction. One of the things that I really value that Alex brings to the community is that he has a history as, if I can say, an activist. I mean, your level of involvement in a number of different things, and that's, I think, really valuable for the community, because for most of us, certainly for me, this is the first purposeful community I've ever been involved with, and learning as I go. And it's really valuable to have people who've been involved in other loosely knit collectives. And in fact, Ed, I think this applies to you as well. That's been really helpful to help give us, what's the word, adherence, you know, within our group. It's very valuable to learn from others. So, Alex, great that you could join us. Thank you for being here. Ed, would you like to say hello, introduce yourself and where you're from and your work with TiddlyWiki in the usual way?
Certainly. My name is Ed Dixon. I'm in Las Cruces, New Mexico. I'm a former educator in many different places, from college music, elementary school music programs, correctional vocational programs, college level technical programs, all kinds of things I've taught over about a 30-year career. And I see TiddlyWiki as being an extremely useful tool for the student to keep track of their notes and their thoughts as they progress through a course. And earlier last year, I suggested integration of xAPI with TiddlyWiki, and that picked up some steam, but I don't know that it ever saw light of day. And I wanted to kind of check on that and see if there's been any progress there. And if not, I may grab that torch and keep running. I just, I'm coming out of two brain surgeries. I actually ended up having two.
Wow.
And I'm still kind of in recovery from that, but I think I'm ready to start becoming a little more active here. So I wanted to join in and see where we're at and where we can go from here.
Right. We'll pick up the that discussion first, perhaps. But great to have you back, and really glad you could join us. Appalled to hear. Well, I suppose I'm pleased to hear that you've got two brains. That's the conclusion I reached from having two lots of brain surgery.
Right, yeah, I'm beginning to wonder myself what's going on there, to tell you the truth.
Well, all the more pleased that you're here to join us today, Ed. Next, Matt, would you like to say hello and introduce yourself in the usual way?
Yes, indeed. I'm Matt from Stockholm, Sweden. I'm a long-time Tiddly user. I am not a competent coder, but I come with various ideas and aspects and angles instead. And I host the site Twaddle at twaddle.tiddlyspot.com, that contains a well, a bunch of various thoughts and ideas on things. But it hasn't been updated for a few months now, actually. So don't go there just now. Take it some other day.
Well, on the other hand, I think everybody should go there and bombard you with email begging you to update it. That seems
that's very flattering to hear. That's very
flattering. Productive outcome. It's hilarious that you're so self-deprecating. Only in the TiddlyWiki community does this happen. It reminds me of The Wizard of Oz, actually, that here's Matt, who actually is fearsomely productive in the world of TiddlyWiki and regularly displays a deep understanding of TiddlyWiki in the things that he makes it do, and yet he is saying that he doesn't. Well, sorry, I was going to jump across to The Wizard of Oz and say that you were saying you didn't have a brain, but that's not exactly what you're saying.
I didn't say that. I'm trying to expand my brain, my learning to code for real now, actually. So hopefully I'll be able to contribute actual code stuff more, well, in a year or two.
Well, yes, that's very interesting. That's something that has cropped up in the group this week, and I think it would be quite interesting to give that a to just have a brief discussion about that. Ed, sorry, what's the name of the interface that I'm supposed to be writing down? Not ActiveX.
Oh, xAPI.
xAPI. I'm so sorry. In the background, I am updating our agenda. And I'm sorry, so having taken so long now, we've taken ages to get to you, Scott. I'm so sorry, but welcome. Scott, would you like to say hello to everybody, introduce yourself, say where you're from, and something about your work with TiddlyWiki?
Certainly. I appreciate the time, actually. For some reason, my the computer I'm on has been spiking here, so I was afraid by the time you would get to me, I would just be all wobbly pixels. My name is Scott Simmons. I work in web development, web content management, and I've been using TiddlyWiki since about 2009. I'm very heavily vested in TiddlyWiki Classic as far as my daily workload goes, and I've really been trying for the last 30 days or so to carve out time in my days to make the leap over to TiddlyWiki 5, which I really should have done about this time last year. Even not wanting to be an early adopter, I've put it off a little long, and so I'm wrestling with the paradigm shifts from one to the other, and to speak to Matt's twaddle site just for a moment. As you say, Jeremy, he is hilariously self-deprecating. It's a wonderful site, especially if you are not steeped in JavaScript and you want to investigate not only the mechanisms by which TiddlyWiki works, the way you can use it to sort and organize your thoughts, and how you can integrate it into your workflows. It's a very friendly TiddlyWiki theory site. And anybody who is wrestling with whether this is the solution for them or something that they want to dive further into, I know it can be a little, let's say, daunting coming in the front door. Twaddle is a great place to start before you dive into lines of code and CSS and dive into the immensely helpful Google Groups community, too, in case anybody on YouTube and is unfamiliar with those resources. Lest TiddlyWiki seem a little off-putting at first, there's a tremendous amount of resources behind that door once you walk up to it and knock on it. You'll find not only responses directly from Jeremy on some of these issues, but you will find a community of people who come at this from many angles and have many different takes and solutions on doing what you want to do with TiddlyWiki, and that's something you're not going to find if you're trying to use Evernote to do everything you want to do to sort things. So that's why I'm a big TiddlyWiki fan, and that's why I'm here to listen up and see what I can learn today.
And a big Matt fan as well. I would also add to one of the things that I really like about the Twaddle site is And we've talked about this before, but I think, Matt, you are a clear and good writer, and that's unusual in any field, but it's extremely unusual in TiddlyWiki and some of your pie-in-the-sky sections where you're elaborating on the things in your imagination are really awesome. One of the fun privileges of the project, I think, is looking inside other people's heads.
Guys, really, you're giving me too much. I'm really almost embarrassed here because it's not that exceptional.
That's very odd, isn't it? I don't know how.
No, but how really, I don't know. You're too generous in your comments because it's taking up valuable time from the thing.
And if
there is something, you know, that I would like to say, then you should comment more on Tobias's stuff because he really has, you know, he's providing solutions to things. I'm mostly talking about things, some whining even, but, you know, Tobias is really giving up.
We do occasionally, so now I should bring up both sites just to be clear and to show people, but we do... call out both sites, and I can't. What's Tobias's URL? TB5.tiddlyspot.com. Okay, so I'm just going to quickly screen share because it's rude of us to talk about things without.
Also, Jed, of course, has been bringing up a lot of things.
I think that there's a so the two sites that we're talking about for people following along at home are Tobias Beer's TB5. Hopefully you can see the URL here, tobybeer.github.io/TB5, and I will paste it into the Hangout wiki so you can see me do that. Here is the URL of Matt's site. So let me just very briefly show you. So Twaddle is
and also there. Also as someone Alex commented on the other side on the side here, Tobias's new site is good too. I don't remember the address for that though, but he has a new site. No.
He does, you're right, and I can't remember the URL. But, I mean, look, one of the things that I value, I think said that we shouldn't be doing this too much mutual congratulations, but I really appreciate the ground that Matt covers, and we talked about this before, that he's he not only speculates about kind of future TiddlyWiki stuff, but he does so in a way that's quite actionable for me. So I'm leafing through looking for diagrams. I think there's a few diagrams I've come across here that, it's under proposals, I think. So these proposals make, fairly big, meaningful, lumpy proposals for changing the way that TiddlyWiki works. And so we should be so lucky that anybody is laying that stuff out in a way that's as easy as that for other people to follow. It's far easier to follow what's going on in Matt's mind than it is to follow what's going on in my mind. And as you say, the phenomenal thing about Tobias's site is the way that he has he collects together very assiduously the hints and tips that emerge on the group. I'm not sure if I'm navigating my way. Okay, so here's a pointer to a plugin that Tobias has just done. But a number of resources, hints and tips, solutions, I guess, is what I might need to be looking at. So these categorized solutions, 48 things to do with lists, and, gosh, how extensive and amazing is that? And the thing that's particularly cool is that Tobias has done this, as far as I can tell, largely in response to discussions on the group. So what you've got here isn't just Toby's or my idea of what would be an interesting selection of topics. It's a tried and, it's what we've experienced are the topics that people are interested in asking about. Dave, hello. Very welcome. I'm very happy to see you here. How are you doing? We're very slowly still on the introductions. Would you like to say hello and introduce yourself?
Hi, my name is Dave Gifford, and I'm in Mexico City. I've been with TiddlyWiki for a long time as a user and doing different things, and a lot of noise here, so I'm going to turn my microphone off, but I just wanted to listen in. Blessings.
Great that you could join us. Thank you, Dave. Really cool. So today there was one topic that cropped up while we were doing the introductions, and this was Ed reminding us that about a year ago there was 2 or 3 months of fairly concerted activity within the community to try to implement connectivity between TiddlyWiki and the tincan xAPI. And the xAPI, very roughly, is a standardized API for our context, that's a way for education software to record student progress on a centralized system. And Ed had, I think, beautifully identified that it was doing that work would be a great sort of multiplier in terms of TiddlyWiki's effectiveness in an education environment. Because for those organizations that were capable of receiving tincan API updates, it meant that any teacher who was using TiddlyWiki in a learning context could integrate at least the reporting part of it with the institution within which they're teaching. And it was really a fascinating approach, fascinating way of thinking about that market. And as we went through this work, we did quite a lot of discussion about how to communicate TiddlyWiki's benefits in education. I think endlessly went around this kind of conundrum that there are educators out there who are using TiddlyWiki right now in an educational context, and yet somehow capturing what they're doing and making it applicable to a broader audience, that remains a tricky challenge. So I was very grateful that Ed had identified, a simple technical task that could be performed that might improve the utility of TiddlyWiki in that context. And I'm afraid, Ed, in the spring of this year, the project basically got steamrolled by my need to organize a day job. And that, over the summer, I dropped a lot of TiddlyWiki work in the sort of April, May, June, July timeframe. And it's only in the last few weeks that I've been trying to make a more conscious effort, particularly to reestablish the Hangouts, because if all else fails, the Hangouts seems to be not a bad skeleton around which to hang, our community activities. So nothing has changed really beyond, as you said, what's changed for Jeremy since then is that I'm still working and I still don't have as much time to spend on TiddlyWiki as I would like. xAPI remains an awesome idea that I would really like to execute, and as we discussed in the past, it's not an outrageous challenge. The actual connecting the pieces together and making it work, there is existing JavaScript code that invokes the tincan API. The challenge in performing the project was always figuring out how to expose that functionality in a way that would be useful to people who were authoring lessons, learning experiences in TiddlyWiki, and to people who were performing them. So I think if we can figure out a way to keep that work going, that would be a great outcome. But although I'm slightly more on top of things than I was in the spring, I am still frustratingly not as free as I would like.
Well, that makes two of us, Jeremy.
You've got even more being under the knife, I'm afraid, it goes even more of a legitimate obstacle to progress. Matt's just saying in a minute, Jeremy, Ed, could you do a 1 minute presentation on it for us? And I think by it you mean xAPI, and since I've just waffled on about it, it might be very helpful to hand that over to you, Ed. Would you like to explain to Matt, to everybody, what is the xAPI? Why is it worth us working with it?
I didn't come prepared for that. Actually, there are some websites available through the xAPI website that can demonstrate exactly what Jeremy was describing. I thought Jeremy did a great job of describing it. but it can actually show the interaction between a learning record store, an LRS, and xAPI calls to it, so that the browser can actually make a call to the LRS, and in that call, it can establish a connectivity to provide the student's progress, whatever the student, you know, the student watched X number of videos, completed X number of tasks. It's a formalized language that's based on a real simple concept of basically who did what. So it's the simplicity of it is one of its greatest virtues, I think, and TiddlyWiki also shares that same virtue, in my opinion. You know what I mean? In its concept of breaking down bite-sized pieces of information, which is what makes it so perfect for education. So I wish I came better prepared, and I'll try to be better prepared next time to maybe show what's available on their site anyway. I don't have anything to demonstrate in TiddlyWiki itself yet.
No problem. From you, Ed. I think of xAPI as being kind of like the reverse of RSS. This is probably the most unhelpful way, because probably Matt and others might not know what RSS is. But RSS is a simple format that has been defined for websites to publish their what has changed to robots, basically. So it's a recent changes for websites, and you get RSS readers that do that. And it turns out that although RSS is an almost embarrassingly trivial technical thing, it's actually a little bit poorly defined in some ways, but its existence is what drove the blogging explosion of 12 years ago or so. And so it's a great example of a really simple technology that's almost more than a technology, it's a convention to use certain symbols in a certain way. It's a very, very lightweight piece of work, but establishing it and it becoming part of a broad agreement between the constituents changes everything in terms of how productive and fertile that environment becomes for interchange. And we saw that with RSS briefly. It's kind of died away now, but there was a bit of an ecosystem powered by RSS. It seemed very exciting when everybody thought briefly there was money in it. But one of the things that's very thought-provoking about education is, even though probably all of us could imagine being 10 times richer and still not being too rich, if you see what I mean, there is actually money in education, and there will always be money in education, because every parent's first concern is, an almost universal concern is for people to give the best opportunity they can for their children and the children of the society that they are brought up in. And education is, therefore, I'm sure, going to continue to be a preoccupation and also something that people find it easy to justify spending money on. So, everybody wins. Education is the, it's the commercial, I mean, it's a great commercial answer. It's a great business to be in, as well as something that is worthwhile and interesting. So, in terms of taking this forwards, I am very keen on this project. I don't think I can commit time to it at the moment. It's the sort of thing that, Matt, you were talking about learning to program, and there was a discussion on the group earlier. I made the point that nowadays it's quite commonplace for people to do online courses for learning to program. People sign up for Code Academy, places like that, and you get little points when you do little exercises, and it's great if it works for people. Couldn't be more delighted to see that phenomenon. I mean, I should be so lucky that the thing that I love has suddenly become something that other people want to do. But my own experience is that to become good at programming, you need to do lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of it in a great cycle. And the only way to really maintain the enthusiasm for that is for you to be deeply engaged in the outcome of the programming that you're doing. Perhaps for you, xAPI could be that. I mean, This is putting you under unwarranted pressure, Matt, and so please just consider this to be a thought experiment. But I think you may know what HTTP is. HTTP is the underlying protocol that powers the web, and it is defined in terms of browsers doing things to servers and servers responding. And it's a very simple protocol. It's very gloriously, gloriously simple. And xAPI is actually that in order to register the fact that Jeremy sat through the advanced astrophysics module and did this exercise and this exercise, you do an HTTP post to a particular URL, and then the server at the other end registers that information. So it's a, you know, as I described it as one operation. That's a huge cascade of things that happens in order for that data to be sent from the client to the server. But it's conceptually very simple, and the APIs are very simple. And in terms of, you know, my central point is you'll do better with programming. Rephrase it. The more you can engineer the payoff to be fantastic and to make a difference to you, the more enthusiastic, you know, the easier you will find it to be enthusiastic. And it may be that xAPI is that. It's a topic that's kind of in the group. It's kind of blocked, as I say, on Jeremy maybe a bit, but there's great level of interest in it. Jeremy is sitting on the side saying it's not that complicated. Anyway, I'm full
just
of...
Just a question. Is it a language to learn, or is it written in some language?
And xAPI is an API, so it's a convention for how you talk to a server over HTTP. So the sort of stack of technology that you encounter is JavaScript in order to make the HTTP call. And then the HTTP call is defined in things in terms of whether it's a get or a put or a post, and you probably come across those phrases. And then basically, actually, an HTTP request is not unlike a tiddler. It's a bundle of name value pairs and a body, and you know, there's complexities the closer you get to it, but from a distance it's just a bundle of, you know, names and values. And the most, you know, the bit that you'll be most engaged in, or anybody that's doing this task will be most engaged in, is understanding the specifics of how the xAPI is exposed in HTTP. So that would be things like, what actual URL do I post the JSON package of the student's results to? And you know, the xAPI standard tells you that. Yeah, JavaScript textbooks tell you how to use XML HTTP requests. Anyway, but I mean, I'm so sorry. I have a personality defect which causes me to occasionally make unsolicited suggestions of what other people should do, and it's a terrible thing to do, Matt. You should do what you want to do. But of course, I'm doing it because it's something I want to do, and so, you know, I'm disappointed and therefore trying to push it onto other people.
Considering how many times I've kind of asked you to do things in TiddlyWiki that I thought were brilliant ideas, I can take a few suggestions myself.
That's true. You're very good at making suggestions, but it is partly the skills that you've got in doing that makes me think that. You know, maybe, just maybe, that kind of challenge would be fun for you. Anyway.
I appreciate it. Can I ask, you brought up that it was a kind of reversed RSS, and that, you know, that it kicked off blogs and everything. I don't know if you've demonstrated it in a previous Hangout, but you had some tool very recently to publish single tiddlers for a blog type application.
That's a good point. And I don't think we have looked at this in any detail, and so perhaps this would be a good moment to do that. There's a couple of other things on the list, but let's just dive into that one very briefly. So, as ever, there's a bit of history here, that we think of TiddlyWiki primarily as being a big ball of JavaScript that runs in the browser and does its magic within the browser, but a design goal for TiddlyWiki 5 was always that it could operate as a static site generator, which is this idea that instead of TiddlyWiki doing its processing interactively, putting stuff on the screen for you to interact with, that it could do that in advance, that in batch mode, so to speak, it could process your wiki text into HTML, and then that HTML could be what's known as a static website, a website without any logic on the server. And you'll see me endlessly emphasizing, apparently overemphasizing, how significant that is. So I'm a huge fan of static servers, and this puts me at odds, well, until recently it's put me at odds with most developers. For most software people, a server is not a scary thing. It's just a computer that you can't touch. It's a computer in the sky that you can't touch. But you treat it like a computer. And to put an app, you know, to get a Ruby on Rails application running, you configure the server and you get it running. And the server does exactly what you want, just like a computer on your desk does. But the crippling disadvantage of putting servers like that on the internet is that they don't scale. So historically, you know, you'll all be used to this idea of sites that get a certain level of publicity and then they fall over. And to me, that is unforgivable. That is software developers like me just failing dismally by doing the easy thing, which is to write a little bit of code that generates a web page on demand, and not go that little extra step to try and architect it so that instead of being the conceptually simplest thing that could be done to address the problem, it's actually a good solution to the problem. And static sites, the point about a static server is that they're of the order of 1,000 times faster than a dynamic server, and as many zeros as you like more reliable, because a static server is doing a very simple deterministic job of transferring bytes from disk out to the network port. And you can write a static server in a few hundred lines of C code. You write an incredibly simple one that you know has no vulnerabilities because it has no intelligence. Whereas, as developers, you know, what is a software developer? Somebody who creates complexity out of thin air. We love to load our servers up with lots of intelligence so they can do all the fancy stuff. And it's often not us, the software developers, who bear the consequences of the liability that running a server sets up. So I'm sorry, maybe not being as coherent as I would like to be, but I'm trying to say that hosting stuff on the web on static servers is the way to go. Hosting stuff, you know, the reason why Facebook and Google are complicated things is because they're dynamic sites that are being served to many hundreds of millions of users. And if you can, bend requirements so that you can use a static server, then you get to take advantage of this enormous speed improvement, enormous reliability improvement. And it's really the answer to yet another long, often criticism of TiddlyWiki, that TiddlyWiki exists and is what it is because it's a way of reusing the browser for you to do useful things on your computer that aren't owned in the cloud. It's about reusing the browser. But we also put it on the web because we can. And so software developers kind of hate TiddlyWiki because they see it's a big ball of JavaScript on the web. And rightly, many people have come to see that it's kind of a problem at the moment that the web is filled with websites that want to be applications. And it's a fair criticism. You know, TiddlyWiki, you want to publish a paragraph of information with TiddlyWiki on your TiddlySpot site, your users have to download several megabytes. Now, so notwithstanding the fact that software developers and others like to point out, you know, like to criticize TiddlyWiki and things like it in this regard, of course, now we live in a world where online publications publishing three paragraphs do so in a web page that costs 28 megabytes. Anyway, I'm so sorry. I seem to be rambling today, so apologies. Perhaps you need to help hold me back. This has been the longest ridiculous introduction to static sites, but I'm trying to explain why it's important and why the reason why I'm speaking passionately about it is, as I say, it's something that's been a goal since the beginning of TiddlyWiki, since 10 years ago. I wanted to be able to use TiddlyWiki as a writing environment, to enjoy its facilities, you know, scaffolding to support my brain, but being able to publish in this much more conventional way where visitors to my site just need to consume a plain old HTML file that will work on you know, any browser. So,
and are you saying that your this publishing of Tiddlers that you have a demonstration of, is that achieving this goal? That's one question, and one question is arose now that when you advocate static sites like that, aren't you missing out on a lot of things? Aren't they much more limited?
Oh, will you just bear with me a second? I'm so sorry. I just need to answer the phone. Bear with me.
Are we alone, guys? Party! Okay, never mind.
Now's the time to start talking about all that stuff about Jeremy.
Yeah, exactly.
I think he's gone for a drink.
Maybe he quit TiddlyWiki altogether and just moved.
The pressure got too much for him.
Yeah. All my stupid questions drove him off.
Matt, by the way, I love your ceiling, by the way.
My ceiling, yeah.
It just epitomizes some sort of Scandinavian coolness that us English people just get.
From the 70s. I moved into a house from the 70s, so that's why it looks like this. Sorry, Jeremy's back. Cut it. Don't talk any bad stuff about Jeremy now. Now we have to get back.
Yeah, no, it's not so much that. You've got to put up with my rambling again. So, Matt, you were asking me a question. Forgive me.
Yes, two questions actually. One was if you answered yes to this, that the demo you're doing on publishing individual tiddlers as static sites, if that fulfills your needs for this static publishing engine. But there hasn't been much discussion on your solution there. I hope there can be more discussion on the board. For instance, would it be possible to use that as a functional blog tool to just post blogs?
That's my goal. Yes. So, thank you, Matt. I'm sorry. I'll take 30 seconds to meander around to a more direct answer to your question. So yes, my goal is to make TiddlyWiki a great blogging tool. And so the argument here might go something like blogging tools tend to be focused on publication, on presentation, lots of themes and so on, not so much on the authoring process. And TiddlyWiki maybe, as a blog authoring tool, might give some people a kind of scaffolding by allowing them to write in pieces and compose them together and perhaps explore things like a blog that isn't a reverse chronological linear dump of items, but say something that consumers consume as a blog, but maybe structured differently, structured other than by time being the primary axis.
Are you using it as a blog now?
Yeah. I'm just holding off giving you the demo. I'll show you in a second. Yeah.
Okay.
So there's been, right since the beginning of Tiddlywiki, so this goal of being able to generate static HTML has been really clear. It's been a big driver, and it's what Tiddlywiki does under Node.js. There is no DOM under Node.js. There's no browser there. So it generates static HTML, which is shipped to the server. I mean, shipped to the client. There's been a number of the necessary features have been in TiddlyWiki 5 since the beginning, and then we've irregularly exposed some of them. So one of the things that Dave's just been pointing to, and let me now click through to show you, is the facilities within TiddlyWiki to export an individual tiddler. So Dave, actually you should demo this. The link that you posted in the sidebar I think is to the TiddlyWiki, but could you demo making an edit to the TiddlyWiki and then generating the static HTML file?
Sure, let me see a minute here.
And so what Dave's preparing to show us is he's taking advantage of a feature that's been in TiddlyWiki for a while, which is to, in the browser, to be able to export an individual tiddler or all tiddlers as static HTML. And that's obviously, it's exposing the basic capability in the core of TiddlyWiki that's always been there, this ability to generate static HTML. What Dave's going to show you is fascinating because he's made it look great. I mean, he's taken a, you know, a kind of a feature and given it a little bit more meaning and purpose. It's really very interesting. So hopefully, are you ready to share, Dave?
Yeah, I think so. Hold on. Okay, screen share.
Meanwhile, Jeremy, maybe you can answer my other question then.
Yes.
Doesn't static sites, isn't that much more limited? I'm just judging from the word.
Yes. So a static site, the limitation of a static site is that there's no intelligence on the server, but there is intelligence on the in the browser. So in fact, tiddlywiki.com right now is, in one sense, it's a static site because there's no logic on the server. But in the sense that we normally mean, it's highly dynamic because although there's no logic on the server, there's an awful lot of logic in the client that is, you know, doing its stuff. And have I answered your question?
Partially, yeah. About the logic.
No, I'm sorry, Michelle, I got lost. Yeah. But we're also we've been joined by Nathan. Nathan, have you got a microphone? I'm going to assume that Nathan is microphoneless, but hopefully, if he can get himself organized, he can introduce himself in a little while. Dave, it looks like you're ready to screen share, so let's come over to you.
All right. This is a TiddlyWiki that I have in my computer. It's a regular TiddlyWiki local file. And I can click on a link, and it'll take me down to another Tiddler. Then I can click on the home button, and that'll take me back up to the table of contents. And then what I do is I have the hide the sidebar inside of the more section of the toolbar, and I also have the save changes in there as well. That way I don't have to depend on the sidebar when I'm ready to publish. And then I go ahead and upload that using FileZilla. And then here's the result online. You can see that the home button is moved to the left of the Tiddler title. I'm not sure why that is. But I can click on a link, and it'll zap me to the Tiddler. And then I can click on the home button, and it'll take me back up to the table of contents. So this is really helpful for my users who are not always very tech savvy. Some of the TiddlyWiki stuff can be very confusing for them because they're not used to some of that stuff. And this is it's a very light static page that gets generated, so it's very mobile friendly for them. And a lot of people here in Mexico don't have computers. They have just cell phones, smartphones, and so forth, and some of them have some tablets, but mostly they're looking at this through smaller mobile devices. So having something that's and the other thing about this too is that with the with it expanded like that, then it's also for the most part
mobile friendly.
Yeah, well, I mean, in terms of the tiddlers and everything kind of collapse down if the screen is smaller, right? Mm-hmm. So that you're not seeing the sidebar. Because I've noticed in TiddlyWiki that if you look at it on a small, on a cell phone or on a tablet that's in portrait mode, that what you see is the sidebar and you don't even see the tiddlers. Being able to publish it like this, they see the tiddlers only, and if they reduce the screen size or something, then the size of the tiddler squeezes to conform to that.
Yeah, and there's no question in the kind of situation you're in where, as I understand it, a lot of the time you're preparing stuff that's being published to other people, and those people, they've got much more limited channels of contribution than you have as the author. And so it's always been a bit lopsided to give those users the burden of using a full-fledged TiddlyWiki. So, but I think what's cool about this is that, let me screen share. I just wanted to show very briefly that what Dave has just shown you is actually equivalent to, oh, and I should show you on the web, if you go to tiddlywiki.com/alltiddlers.html, and this is, again, a static HTML file that contains all of the tiddlers from tiddlywiki.com. When you click on a link, it has this behavior of jumping to the scrolling through the page to jump to the relevant tiddler. So in a read-only sense, it actually behaves a lot like TiddlyWiki. You can be reading something, click on a link, you can go back to get back to where you were, and it's, you know, taking advantage of the existing affordances that web browsers offer for reading HTML content. But although that feature has been in TiddlyWiki 5 since the beginning, it was initially only exposed in Node.js. Oh, I just realized that I'd switched to Dave while I was doing that demo, so everybody's going to see that demo as a tiny little box in the corner, but still, that's okay. You'll have seen roughly what I meant.
I saw it just fine, Jeremy.
It'll have been all right for you live because you were seeing your own stream, but the recording is kind of my stream. So,
I think we saw his.
I was doing the demo, you would have seen it full screen, but the recording will show Dave reacting to the demo full screen. It's fine though. I'm sure that people will figure it out. But so what's been happening here is what's changed is here's a feature that's been in TiddlyWiki literally since November 2011. The thing that changed, I can't remember when it was, 5.1.9 period or something, was the exposure on a menu that Dave's used. So it's a really interesting point that in order to transform Dave's ability to use TiddlyWiki in these very important circumstances that he was talking about with users who aren't on computers, who are on mobile phones, on limited connectivity, what we needed to do was not to implement that functionality, but was kind of to shift the interface to it so that instead of being a matter for Node.js people, it becomes something that you can do in the browser. And it was actually a very small amount of work on my part to do. And the reason why I'm emphasizing that way of looking at it is because it just emphasizes how much low-hanging fruit there is in TiddlyWiki development, as in how many places we could make TiddlyWiki significantly more useful for Dave, because you're the example that we're talking about, without big fundamental developments, without, you know, rearranging how search results are displayed, but just by making some of the existing features, fundamental features of the core, more accessible, easier to use, easier to communicate, well, make better communicate to people what those features are capable of doing. So I'm very pleased to see this happen. And now finally, let me run into the demo that you've been promised. So as I said, the prompt was me wanting to do my own blog. Now, in fact, this was nothing ever changes, because this was, in fact, my prompt for doing TiddlyWiki in the first place. So in 2004, I wanted to write on the web. I didn't like the idea of writing within the constraints of a blog, so I thought, oh, hey, I'll write my own thing instead, this, you know, a personal wiki that you write and publish. And so there's kind of a sense in which TiddlyWiki has always been a displacement activity that's getting in the way of Jeremy writing a blog. But now, finally, when I was speaking at a conference in October, I finally pushed through with the last bits of work. So now I have a custom domain, germaline.com, that points to, in fact, a GitHub Pages account that features the blog. It's not perfect at the moment. So front page is just a listing of the pages, and each post is like that. And most of them have links in, and so there's also, when I link to germaline.com/frigiwiki, this is an ancient TiddlyWiki prototype, but it's now hosted on the blog, if you see what I mean, even though it's old classic TiddlyWiki. And there's also a So there's posts and there's pages. Posts are the reverse chronological things, and pages are things like about, information about, and it's hosted on GitHub. So my Germaline, which is my GitHub account, my GitHub pages account was already being used to host tiddlywiki.com. So I created an organization on GitHub, of which I am the only member, called Germaline-blog, and the side effect of that is that I get another GitHub pages account. But it also means that it's quite nice, actually, that it means if you wanted to copy this, you only need to copy these two repos. You don't need to get bogged down and sidetracked by everything that's in the main TiddlyWiki repo. So the easy one is germaline-blog.github.io. That's how GitHub pages works. That is the actual HTML files that are being generated. So when I update the blog, I make changes to the wiki and then generate these HTML files and then push them up to this repository. And that mirrors how we publish tiddlywiki.com as well. And then this blog repository, I'm actually going to switch over to my editor to show you what that looks like, because it's a tiny bit easier to navigate through. So here, I'm not sure how much detail it's worth going in for this. There's, as ever, simple things rapidly accrete tiny bits of complexity that can make the opening thing look a bit more complicated. But let me try and take you through it. There's an archive folder that literally is stuff that I didn't want to throw away. An artwork folder where things like fab icons live. And oh yes, and I had to make an animated GIF for the presentation, so that lives in there. Then main wiki is the one you'll be familiar with. That's a conventional TiddlyWiki
question,
folder.
Just,
oh, sorry.
Was this is your structure? Where is this structure actually?
This is in the blog repo. So again, sorry for the rapid switching. So here I'm showing you the repo on GitHub. So this is the repo where the content, editable content, the source content, so to speak, for the blog lives. And then adjacent to it, this repo is where the output of the blog lives, which is the files that are ultimately statically hosted by GitHub. So what's in here is, for instance, there's a build script. So my procedure for making a change all my content lives here in this wiki. So there's the blog post that we were looking at. I can change that, and then I need to run build, and then I run stage, and then I run GitHub push to actually push the results to GitHub. So the workflow that I've got here is the only people who could love it are people who are happy working with GitHub and so on. And that's clearly not a requirement for using TiddlyWiki as a blog. But it happens to be the way that I want to work, and so it makes sense as the first thing to hit. So there's your TiddlyWiki folder containing all my posts. There's a server link to it so that I can edit it with serve.sh. The static assets is all those things I'm hosting, like FrigiWiki and Cecily and so on. And then the talky-talky stuff is actually independent of the blog, that if you go to germaline.com/talky-talky, you get the actual presentation that I was giving in October. And I think I have talked about this in the Hangouts. It's a refinement of the earlier presentation framework I've been using. So I'm so sorry. If you're managing to follow this, then you're probably doing pretty well, because this has turned out to be a slightly chaotic overview. But so what I'm showing you there is that I've got a TiddlyWiki. I chose that for me the most convenient form for that TiddlyWiki is that it's a wiki folder that I run under Node.js. And then, again, for me, the most convenient thing is a batch file that I run that then executes the wiki, does it essentially exactly what we saw Dave doing when he clicked export, only I'm doing it with a batch file behind under Node.js. And the end result is a very lightweight blog that anybody can read on any device with no dependency on JavaScript, and yet I get to keep my familiar writing environment, which I like. So, sorry. No, go on, Matt, please.
If someone was not familiar with TiddlyWiki and said that, oh, I want to start a blog, what should I say to that person? Why does it make sense to solve that need with TiddlyWiki?
I don't think it does. I think this is blogging for people who already have an investment in TiddlyWiki. So if the only thing, if literally one's only, the only intended outcome was that a blog should appear that people can read, then for most people they should go to Blogger or the other Squarespace. There's lots of great, I don't know how great they are, but there are lots of blogging services. And the great thing about those is that they let, if you want to blog, they let you focus on the writing. And really, although here I am creating all of these technical obstacles to publishing a blog, needing to create a static site publishing system and so on, but actually, for most people, I believe that the obstacle to having a blog and the, you know, the thing that's difficult about it is getting your head around the writing. And so in a way, if you're not already invested in TiddlyWiki, doing your writing on TiddlyWiki is likely to give you yet more distractions and so on.
But in defense of those people who are heavily vested in TiddlyWiki, my limited experience with blogging, it always starts with Tiddlers and ends with me having to grab all my text from Tiddlers and then run a couple of search and replaces to clean them up and post them on blog. So, you know, there is
exactly
an audience
that. If you're us, it's the perfect solution. And it's a beautiful feature for TiddlyWiki because it's kind of cheap to do. But you're right. I mean, my value, for me, the value is exactly, I think I almost said this at the beginning, I treat TiddlyWiki as scaffolding for my brain to help compensate for the self-evident shortcomings of my brain. And I rely on TiddlyWiki all the time to kind of pull those pieces together. And being able to, you know, so given that's the place where my brain is functioning, that really all sounds a bit too biological, it's a great place for me to publish. But,
Jeremy?
Hiya.
One answer to the question about what we would say to new people is that if you publish something as a river of tiddlers, then really what you're doing is publishing quite a number of different blog entries at the same time. And at the same time, you can later on add to your TiddlyWiki and then with one click republish the entire river, and you've got even more interconnected tiddlers.
Well, and I think we can make the workflow even simpler. I mean, the way that you're doing it in the browser is pretty nice because you've been able to customize it. You've shown us how you've customized the drop-down menu so that it suits the operations that you need to do, and that's allowed you to kind of accelerate that publication process. And I can see ways it could probably be accelerated even further. But I think we need to make it much easier to use, and this could be a good segue into Tiddly Desktop, which was nervous about occupying the discussion with topics that I've chosen, but something I wanted to talk about a tiny bit. And the segue is this, that what I would like to be able to do is to write my blog using Tiddly Desktop on my computer, to be able to, at will, make modifications to it on my phone and so on, but still primarily my computer. When it comes to typing, that's mostly on my computer. And then I want to be able to press a button which just then chunders away and does the publishing of the blog without me having to make any further interjections. So that we're there's no reason with Tiddly Desktop why we can't do a completely turnkey publishing solution where the procedure for writing a new blog post is start Tiddly Desktop, click on the thing that says My Blog to open My Blog, click on New Post, write, okay, close window, hit publish, bang, my blog's up to date. That's where we want to get. And the, you know, all the mechanisms are there. It is about, to the point I was making before, really, it's about making that process smoother, making it so that there's, you know, I mean, literally, we need to optimize the number of clicks so that it's brain dead easy. And my experience of publishing in the past is, my experience of publishing with TiddlyWiki is, I've said several times, for me to publish updates to tiddlywiki.com is a ridiculously convoluted process, and it has a catastrophic effect on the up-to-dateness of tiddlywiki.com. So I think if you plan to publish stuff online, my advice, which I haven't been very good at taking for myself, is to take the time out to absolutely accelerate your publication process before you start so that you can just go, so that there's no friction to each post. Scott's making is expressing rather nicely, I think, something we've both been trying to say, that TiddlyWiki is a much better organization structure for old content than WordPress. I'm much struck by that. I mean, I know people who have been blogging for 12 years, and you look at a lot of them have stopped. And part of the reason why they've stopped is if you blog for 10 years, you end up with a big pile of blog posts, and they're almost useless. A point that I think, again, I've probably made lots of times, is the difference between a transcript of events and a summary of events made by somebody with an eye to what that summary is needed for. And a transcript just turns out to be almost always the most useless thing, and least instructive thing. So a blog is a transcript of the thoughts that you chose to publish. But by lacking that ability to structure and make it coherent, it sort of denies, some people might say, what we need to do as we go through our lives is to make sense of our lives. You know, we compose a story and narrative for ourselves. Making sense of what's happened is a really important thing for us. Blogs give us this awesome way to record what happens in a way that for some people seems to be compulsive, and you know, they're able to continue, they can keep the momentum going. And yet it seems to just miss that opportunity of the then what. You know, when I'm quite old now, but you know, one of the privileges of age should be to look back on the past and think about it, you know. And so yes, I'm now saying more than Scott said in his much more elegant point.
I'm going to jump in there if you don't mind, Jeremy. I despise the organization of traditional blogs, and I suspect in part that's because they were built with no eye toward their long-term existence.
Yeah. My theory is that the blogs were designed how they are to solve one problem, and the problem they're solving is to make the next post the easiest thing for you to do. So that's all they're for. It's just about lowering the barriers, making it so you need this little commitment and self-worth.
And modern social media has expanded from there and taken that role that blogging has.
Yes.
But we're left with blogging platforms that are primarily designed for a function they're no longer the best thing for. When I come to a new blog, it's almost impossible to begin to read it. So many blogs, you know, will begin with personal narratives. I can't even tell who the author is, you know, or what his or her background is. I think a TiddlyWiki blog, one of the real advantages there, because of its underlying structure, TiddlyWiki is amenable to being reorganized on the fly constantly. Mm-hmm. So you can update your tags, you can update your organization, you can rearrange your structure. Without having to go back and do massive overhauls to the past is constantly with you in TiddlyWiki, and you can reorganize it. If you have a way that you want to present a narrative flow of information with an actual beginning, middle, and end, especially in an educational context where you might have, you know, now you might use a blog for that to cover all the material you want to cover in a semester, doing that with a traditional blog, the navigation is terrible for that. A TiddlyWiki blog would allow you to do that, put that out there, update it again next semester, keep that information current, and still have, you know, a little bit of hand-holding and narrative lead-through from the beginning of the blog to the end of the blog that allows you to step in outside the linear progression as you need to, but still see the progression. And to me, I think it's a very niche kind of blogging at the moment, but I feel like it's something that's been neglected, and I feel there's a lot of potential here for people who use TiddlyWiki if it can become a widely accepted tool that would be an entree for people who are put off by blogging because they don't want an open-ended forever project, but they want to begin working on something that's going to take them a few weeks, a few months, maybe this year, and then be done with it.
I noticed a lot of people using blogging platforms like WordPress for things other than they were designed, that, you know, gratifyingly for WordPress, it's become the default answer for publishing. It's the tool that everybody knows. And amazingly, I know one site that is a WordPress site, and it's a grimoire of a series of books that I really like. So basically, it's just got as headings all of the people, various sort of things, topics that crop up in the book, and then there's a paragraph or two about each of them, and I'm sure you'll have come across those about books that you love as well. And it's a really nice way to kind of consume a regurgitated version of a series of books that you enjoy. And it's a labor of love by somebody who, like me, is a fan of this series of books. But he's done it on WordPress. And I look at it and think, wouldn't it be amazing to have that in TiddlyWiki so that it became, you know, what I would see in my mind, a kind of intertwingled, cross-linked, much sort of richer, gloopier collection. So that, the Tiddly desktop point was to say, wouldn't it be cool if we could use Tiddly desktop as the front end for tasks like blogging? So publishing a blog to a static site, is there are tasks in there that are difficult for TiddlyWiki in the browser to do? That's the fundamental problem. And people can already do those tasks under Node.js, but that's insufficient. We need to make those tasks simpler so we lower the bar for more people. And I'm finally happy about Tiddly desktop. So I promised to write this up, and I haven't. So, Scott, so are you just the point that you've raised, Scott, is okay. Let me just get this in the right order. So, Scott, I'm going to come to the point that you raised in the window. Forgive me for just going back on myself a tiny bit. So, Tiddly desktop. I started work on it in December, January last year. So, it came out first version January 2014. It was first conceived of as a custom browser for TiddlyWiki that had this innate capability to save TiddlyWiki documents back to the disk. And very quickly, first version accomplished that. Then something really annoying happened. A high proportion of the feedback that I got was people wanting it to be more like a browser, so wanting search in page, zoom in page, spell checking, all of the features that people have come to take for granted in browsers. And that left me with a great difficulty, because if I try to, you know, for Tiddly desktop to compete as a great browser that people want to use against Chrome and Firefox and, you know, all the other great browsers up there, that's a I'm going to lose. There's just no way I can do that. So for about the last 9 months, I've been really bothered by Tiddly desktop. I've been uncertain about what it's for, because although it does functionally this vital thing of allowing you to save changes, it's not a great browser. It's a cranky, slightly weird browser that misses features that you're used to. And yet, as I say, getting lots of feedback saying I want it to be a better browser. So this has been very vexing, and I have been very uncertain how to proceed. But I still carried on making improvements to Tiddly desktop. So some of those were easy in terms of improving its internal architecture to make it easier to do things to it. But a big change about 5-6 weeks ago was starting to work with using Tiddly Desktop to host Node.js wiki folders. So what I mean there is, as well as being able to open a TiddlyWiki HTML file and save changes, to be able to open a directory such as the one I showed you earlier, a wiki folder directory, which contains individual files representing individual tiddlers. And as well as doing that, this new version, when you open a wiki folder, it also exposes that wiki folder over HTTP so that you can open it in any browser. And that may be so important that I should show you, perhaps, because so let me just run Tiddly Desktop very quickly. Let me screen share and then you can at least see what I'm doing. So I'm just slipping into the Tiddly Desktop source code in order to make one minor change. Oh no, that's fine, I don't need to. Okay, so we're going to run Tiddly Desktop. And it takes a few seconds to start up because it's building. Not only is it building Tiddly Desktop for my machine, it's also building the Windows version and the Linux version and everything else. Hurrah. Okay, so this is the main Tiddly Desktop window. One of the changes over the last two versions is we now represent wikis by their fav icons rather than their thumbnails. I think this is much more useful because the user is in control of the thumbnail, so you can choose a thumbnail that that is recognizable and distinguishable from the other ones, whereas when we were using thumbnails, I found that all the wikis I worked with tended to look exactly the same milky rectangle with gray smudges, and I couldn't really tell the difference between them. So these entries at the top, you can see there's a wiki file, and then there's the path of an HTML file. And if I click reveal, it shows me where those files are. Down here, you can see that for these bottom two entries, it says wiki folder. So instead of being pointing to a TiddlyWiki HTML file, it points to a folder. If I go into the advanced settings, I can set a host and a port. And if I now open that, I get developer tools opened, but for a very embarrassing reason. That's the only place where certain errors will be visible. And if I also reveal the wiki folder, so there's the wiki folder, and now back to Tiddly Desktop. If I create a new tiddler called Hangout 93 and save it, you should see a moment later, there we go, the tiddler Hangout 93 has been created. So what you're seeing here is, here on my disk is a wiki folder with the individual tiddlers comprising that TiddlyWiki. And then here is a window within Tiddly Desktop that's showing me that wiki as if it was in a browser, and I can do all the normal things that I can do in TiddlyWiki. But the extra bit is that little thing I showed you where we, under advanced settings, we specified a host and a port, and that instructs Tiddly Desktop to expose the wiki over HTTP. That means that I can, from another browser, in this case Chrome, talk to the same wiki. So if here I go Hangout 999, then you can see that, you can see that tiddler appears in the other window as well. So this is actually, what you're seeing here is the same as if I was running a TiddlyWiki under Node.js and then opened it in two browsers. But the thing that's most interesting about this is, of course, if I can open the wiki in another browser, why on earth do I want that window? I might as well just start my wiki here and then open it in my favorite browser connecting via HTTP. So that's where I am now, is that I believe that the next version of Tiddly Desktop, oh, I'd missed showing you one interesting little thing. Let me just, I've been joined by more people, so we'll stop in a moment for introductions as well. Tiddly Desktop now has a tray menu. So on Windows, this will be on the bottom right. In my Mac, it's on the top right. And what I think would be the perfect TiddlyWiki for me, sorry, the perfect Tiddly Desktop for me, would be to have that window, as we have at the moment, that's a list of wikis. But up on that tray menu, for that, when I pull down the menu, for it to list all of my wikis, and then if I click on one, for it to open that wiki in my default browser. Now, that doesn't happen at the moment, I hasten to add. But to me, that it dawned on me that that is, I think, the best way for Tiddly Desktop to work. So it stops pretending to be a browser. What Tiddly Desktop becomes is a shell around the Node.js edition of TiddlyWiki, making it much, much easier to use. So, well, one of the things that we've learned is over the last few years with TiddlyWiki is that there are certain things that people who are using TiddlyWiki in the browser would love to be able to do that can only be done in Node.js, and that for most people, that transition of from working in the browser to being comfortable working in Node.js is quite considerable. And I think that's no surprise, because the skills you need to feel confident working on the command line are a long way away from the kinds of skills that many of us have from a lifetime of working with graphical user interfaces. So, problem with Node.js, too hard to use, wrap Tiddly Desktop around it so that everything that Node.js, the TiddlyWiki under Node.js lets you do, should be available with pointy clicky. And Tiddly Desktop itself is extensible, so it would be possible for people to write plugins to, say, handle dragging and dropping videos, so that when you drag and drop a video into your Tiddly Desktop window, it automatically uploads the video into YouTube and then inserts the URL of the video into your text, those types of things. And I think that, as I say, neatly avoids the current conundrum of being destined forever to be a worse browser than Chrome. Scott's just saying in the sidebar, the ability to open a TiddlyWiki by double-clicking on it if I give it a custom extension, e.g. .tw or via open within the context menu. Yes, I'm not I agree that would be incredibly useful. The giving it a custom extension may be maybe a good approach, because certainly on the Mac, and I believe on Windows, the system can be induced to use something other than the file extension, basically to use metadata for the file type. And so it still knows Windows, even if you give an HTML file a non-HTML extension, so I keep talking about Windows, Mac, it still knows that it's an HTML file. And so, yes, maybe we can. I'm not that familiar with those, you know, those kinds of platform integration features, but yes. So Scott's second point was Control F for navigating the content of Tiddlers. So that's what I'm saying, is that I will never do. So the next version of Tiddly Desktop, my goal is it will not have windows that show you the content of your wikis. You will open all of your wikis in your conventional browser. So, in fact, the really clever trick that the next version of Tiddly Desktop needs to pull off is, as you've seen, it's easy for Tiddly Desktop to open a Node.js wiki and to publish it, to expose it over HTTP. The challenge is to do that with a Tiddly wiki that's in a single HTML file. But that's the goal. So I would take my HTML file stored on my desktop, open it in Tiddly Desktop, click on something in Tiddly Desktop that would take me straight through to the URL in my browser corresponding to that. Jed, you kind of, I think what you'd love about, sorry, we should do the introductions. Jed, are you microphoned today? Jed is Saul's microphone, I believe. But Jed was saying in the sidebar, I still haven't used Tiddly Desktop. I should probably change that. Oh, and I haven't let you in. I'm so sorry.
Okay. Yes, I think you have to do that before I can talk. But hello. Yes. As introduction, hi, I am Jed. I used to live in the US, now I live in Paris. I use my TiddlyWiki stuff for keeping track of my thesis work, and now I'm using it for documentation on the web design stuff I'm doing for my job, and I make lots of stuff with it, most recently Snap.js and TiddlyWiki, but yeah, that's me. I do stuff.
Indeed. You've been working on, I think, more Snap.js stuff since last week. Would you like to, we showed us briefly last week, would you like to show us the updates to the animation stuff?
Sure. Should I do that now?
I was at the end of what I wanted to say about Tiddly Desktop, but I suppose before switching over, anybody got any questions or thoughts that they would like to share on Tiddly Desktop?
Am I understanding you correctly, Jeremy, with Tiddly Desktop, that by throwing to the browser, you would still be using all the saving mechanisms in Tiddly Desktop, so you would be bypassing any issues with the browser engines. So therefore, even if you were using some oddball browser, you'd still be able to use all the underlying Tiddly functionality. That's what I thought.
Fact, interesting things, like you could be running Tiddly Desktop on the desktop computer in your closet and then lying on your settee with your iPad editing a TiddlyWiki HTML file stored in your Dropbox directly from the iPad browser.
I could have one install of Tiddly Desktop on my home network and then just be using that for all my devices.
Yes, and if you are the type of person that wishes to expose that network to the internet, then you would be able to do that from the outside. I mean, obviously, TiddlyWiki is not going to help. I mean, it's not TiddlyWiki's job to help you do that, but it's reasonably straightforward, as I understand it. Nathan, are you microphoned, by the way? No, Nathan is on his microphone. Matt's just saying in the sidebar, I'm actually totally relying on my cell phone for surfing and web 100%. I love it when people say that. So we had a glorious moment where somebody, I think it might have been Daniello, but forgive me if it wasn't, revealed that they were writing and debugging JavaScript on their phone. And I just loved that because, you know, I'm now quite old, and I see all the other old people getting, you know, shocked and not being able to cope with all the passage of changes. And I figured out, I may not be that clever, but I figured out that I've got to, you know, you've got to roll with the changes. And the fact that programming, you know, in my lifetime, programming shifted from a thing done by white people in white coats, you know, in appallingly designed 1970s buildings with lots of fanfold paper, to being something that teenagers did in their bedroom, obviously literally in my lifetime, and now it's something that people do at the bus stop on their phones. I'm just absolutely blown away and thrilled by it. Oh, I see. Sorry, Matt is saying, to be clear, he's saying that he's using the phone as his internet connection, so he is tethering. And Nathan's saying he's got a mic but no voice. Nathan, well, I do hope you recover your powers of speech soon, although maybe it's a great opportunity to explore speech synthesis and all these other interesting assistive technologies. You could have a voice of Nathan as a batch file. I'm so sorry, Jed. I'm doing an appalling job of keeping track of things today. But Jed, you are very kindly going to show us the Snap.js stuff you've been working on. I think there's two fascinating things here. The first is it's yet another great example of taking a library that already exists out there, combining it with TiddlyWiki, which is kind of glue, and creating something that's much more useful than either thing on its own. And that's terrific. And you know, the more that people like Jed do this, the more I want to keep pointing out that that's what's happening, because it is something that anybody can do. And I've known Andy, who was on the Hangout a couple of weeks ago. He's done a lot of integrating iframes into his TiddlyWiki, which is, you know, the least technically demanding type of integration, and yet carries you an enormous long way. And you know, so there's that sense of combining two things. But the other thing that's been awesome is to witness just how productive Jed is. So Jed, it seems as though you kind of do a bit of work, you publish it on the group, people say, wow, that's amazing, how can you make it do such and such, and then you posted 1.1, and then Groundhog Day starts again, and we get an even better version the next day. Is that what it feels like to you?
Every so often, yes. I have a very hard time putting down puzzles, so that's kind of why.
And this, okay, well, I should let you do the demo, but I want to, is the palm tree yours, or is that a demo lifted from, I mean, an image lifted from another demo?
Oh, no, I made everything here using the tool that I made.
So it is your palm tree artwork?
Yes.
Excellent. I'm very delighted to see that.
So, yes, okay, I guess by way of very quick background, the snap.js library is a JavaScript library made for SVG graphics. SVG graphics are very lightweight and quick and can be done in browsers, which is why they're good for TiddlyWiki. And somebody in the group brought up that they wanted to use the Snap.js library in TiddlyWiki, and I got sucked in and started playing with it, and this is the result. So the simple things that I have are you can just make SVG images. Like, you can make this image here, and it's a static image, or you could make it as a static image. And then, slightly more complex, you can have the SVG which responds to changes in the wiki, like the bar charts here, which are another simple example I made. But the part that I'm actually interested in now and have been playing with is making animations with it. And like, this is just a simple animation I threw together that I'm using to figure out what features I need to add to make it useful. And I figured the best way to do that is to actually have something in mind and make it. And so every part of this was made using the tools in TiddlyWiki here. And in my video, it's choppy. On my screen, it's not. This example is online at ooktech.com/jed/example-wikis/snap-svg. And yeah, so it's there if you want to play with it. But the way that it works is you have a widget, and I think I just closed the thing that had the widget in it. There's a widget that called, what is it? Oh, it's not here. Snap widget, I believe. And here we are. Yes, this right here, Snap widget. And you give that the name of a SVG surface, which in this case is just a tiddler with that name. And you can give it type of animation if you want to make an animation. If not, then you don't do that. And then you add stuff to it. And let me open up the other one if I can remember which one this is. Here we are. Okay, so to do what I've made is a little generic tool for adding things to the surface, like an ellipse. So you give it some name and the various things that it needs. And then you just say add ellipse. And oh, yes, sorry. Some of the things here are kind of broken. Because of the changes I made to the animation. So give me just a moment. Things are not automatically added to the surfaces. There we go.
Jed, the surface itself,
Ah, that was what I was going to ask you to look at. What's in the surface itself?
Yeah, like I said, I broke some stuff. Okay, yes, this is just the widget.
Okay, and then you ID the surface, right. And then what's in that Tiddler SVG image too?
The Tiddler itself actually just holds...
Got you.
Some very simple... It's the name of it that's important. It just holds the height and width of it. And the play and refresh parts are... Oh, that's why I was doing it. Are used for animation.
And the things that are on that surface are tagged SVG image 2 or something like that.
Yes.
Yeah, brilliant. Gosh, that's nice.
Okay, and I don't know why the error is there. That's actually kind of new.
It's a feature. It's a very beautifully animated error box.
But, so when I get all of that, whatever that error is, fixed, then it works much smoother. But, so you can just choose the image you want to add for... normal polygons. Is this just not going to work at all? Okay, let me work on the first one. Sorry, I probably should have made sure that this worked before.
I know, still, I similarly get embarrassed when you have to watch me typing code and navigating my way to files, but... I think it's quite encouraging for people. It's interesting to see you do things. But we shouldn't watch you debug it, I suppose.
Yes. Well, I have an older version somewhere here. But yes, so let me get this together, and then I'll come back. But I just wanted to show off the animation mostly.
Can I ask some questions? This is really interesting, really cool work, Jed. Take this image, for instance, with the palm tree and everything. Is that one image, or is it like consists of all those polygons, or what is that actually? I mean, how?
It is a bunch of different their elements, I think, is what they're called. These, the ones that are checked here, are the ones that are visible on the surface. Oh, that's why it showed up here. And So
each one of those checks is one, element?
Polygon, yeah, element. And they can be manipulated individually, but then...
So if you uncheck one there, it'll just disappear straight away from the image?
This is a animation, and to make that work without refreshing constantly, I had to turn off the update part, but if it's not an animation, then yes, it just disappears. And like the black circle is gone now.
And if you, it might be interesting, Jed, to right click and do inspect element on one of those things, so that the thing that, quite difficult to see, but the thing that's cool, Matt, is that this image is composed of the same types of elements that we're used to, divs and spans and so on. Only these are elements that define polygons, rectangles, and so on. So it's a wonderful way to do graphics because it lets you reuse everything you know about HTML and CSS. And there's a lot of we've learned about how to animate HTML over the years. But it's a beautiful piece of work, isn't it? Really nice.
And all of these points are like the same polygon that's copied and rotated. So there's a lot of nice things like that you can do. It's one of the reasons that SVG is so fast in a browser.
Yeah.
So if we want to make, like, for instance, instructional videos on how to use TiddlyWiki, I shouldn't say videos, animations, would that make sense in this, or is it? Is that a really too ambitious thought?
Well, I think it depends a bit on your goal, because what Jed is showing you here is indeed an animation authoring tool. Now, in fact, you can, in some situations, you could separate out the authoring and the presentation. So Adobe, for instance, have some desktop applications that let you completely graphically define complex animations. It's basically... what used to be the old Flash authoring tool now writes HTML5, including SVG content. So you could create the artwork there
and then use TiddlyWiki to present it, because once you've created the artwork, it's an SVG file or a bunch of SVG files that need to be combined. So if you think about it, we get a bit of that with the SVGs at the moment. I design the SVGs that are in TiddlyWiki in a graphics package, then I export them as SVGs, and then they become flexible and so on within TiddlyWiki by virtue of that architecture. Did I answer your question? What was your question, Matt?
Yeah, if one could make a small like animated video or something.
So
like
if your goal was to get an animated video done quickly, I'd say install some, if you can. I mean, Adobe's tools, some of them are free. Install some tools that are purpose built for creating animations, because there's there's two goals here, creating a good animation for TiddlyWiki and the quickest way to do that versus the slightly different goal of can we create not only an... You see, what Jed's got here isn't just an animation authoring environment. It's a place where people can create images completely differently than you could in a conventional graphics package, because the promise here, and obviously it's not all there, but I can define with this an image procedurally. I can make a field of grass where I don't need to paint each blade of grass individually, just as Jed has done with the rays of the sun. And so that makes it, if this does turn into an authoring tool, its nature is that it'll be an authoring tool like TiddlyWiki that triumphs at letting you compose and combine modular pieces of content. So the end result won't be, I suspect, it'll be oriented towards, because of its nature, it'll be great at those situations where animations have a kind of logical breakdown, where one can build them up by animating individual elements and so on. Whereas, if you've got a naive animator, I mean, an animator who's been trained in traditional media, they'd probably prefer a tool that, some of what Jed's showing you here is transclusion applied to graphics, in effect. And it's an amazing and powerful concept. But as we know, with ordinary textual transclusion, it's conceptually quite demanding. Not everybody wants to or needs to think about concepts like transclusion. While Jed is still... you've seemed to have stopped the errors, Jed.
Yes, I'm...
I spoke too soon. But this is a great point for me to raise something that I've been meaning to discuss for some time on the Hangout. And so something I have said a number of times is that we've got to get 5.1.10 out, and I'm really hoping to get it out before Christmas so that all those people who have a bit of a break over Christmas, they'll be able to play with the TiddlyWiki 5.1.10. And one of the, so there's code and pull requests and all that stuff to worry about. But the other thing that will happen when we publish 5.1.10 is that there will be a content update to TiddlyWiki.com. And that's incredibly overdue. It's been the summer since we had a content update. Now, one of the things that desperately needs updating is the community links. As in, I have not done a good job over the last year of making sure that every fabulous thing that I see in the world that's interesting to TiddlyWiki people is listed on TiddlyWiki.com. So I'd like to ask your help with that, people. And that's ideally anybody who can send pull requests for, so there's each thing we link to in the community Tiddler on TiddlyWiki.com has its own Tiddler. So if somebody can send a pull request to add Tiddlers for the resources that were missing, and this is prompted by Jed, because right now, if I search on the latest preview for UK Tech, I don't get any matches. So I think that we're not currently linking to anything meaningful of Jed's. And that's ridiculous. That's absolutely absurd, because here's one of the most productive people in the group, generating all this amazing. We've got to make it easy to reach us. So my plaintive request is, if you can send pull requests, send pull requests. If you can just send a list of links to the group, that would also be incredibly helpful, A, because conceivably somebody else other than me can prepare the pull request, but if push comes to shove, I can prepare the pull request. But I think it's easy. For those of you who are organized and who record bookmarks yourself, it is literally a matter of looking at the TiddlyWiki sites that you're already aware of and just very kindly checking to see whether you've got any that have been missed off TiddlyWiki.com at the moment. And as I say, there's always going to be an enormous documentation deficit for TiddlyWiki. But at least if we do a good job of linking out to all these great examples of people doing amazing things with TiddlyWiki, that gives, you know, that opens up a whole different vector for people to learn more, because as we all know, people learn so well by example and by fiddling with what other people have done.
Jeremy, what about the collaboration with Erwin and the I'm hearing my own voice echoing here. Yeah, the with Erwin's TiddlyWiki aggregator project.
There's a ticket on this. What I would like to do is to adopt Erwin's aggregator formally. And I think in the ticket I was suggesting we could up as news.tiddlywiki.com. And the key thing about the approach that Erwin's taking is really important, that if somebody who is the owner of an indexed wiki adds some content, it will automatically make its way through to news.tiddlywiki.com. That's great and is really important. It gives us a way for people to get stuff on tiddlywiki.com without there having to be a whole publication cycle. But the current situation is tiddlywiki.com is what it is, i.e. it is built as a static site by running some batch files from the raw tiddlers. And so that gives us a wee bit of a problem, because it means that we will, you know, any content we want to have on tiddlywiki.com needs to be basically manually produced. But it's also an opportunity, because the really important resources that we want to point people at, we make those resources more useful by describing them clearly. We're not tagging resources very extensively on tiddlywiki.com. But an editorial process is what I'm getting at. And I think both things are needed. The kind of automatic publication fire hose that something like the aggregator gives you is essential for the community. But it does compromise. You know, if that fire hose was on the front page of tiddlywiki.com, it would limit our ability to control people's experience of visiting tiddlywiki.com. And you know, that's problematic. And as I say, the fixes would require us to re-engineer how tiddlywiki.com is produced, and that's not something, well, that's something I want to do, but I would like to do it in the right order. Does that make sense?
Yes. Still,
I'm a huge enthusiast. Sorry, I just knocked something over.
Hey, take it easy over there. there is still the problem with, you know, people. Well, this bottleneck that people have to put in something and it has to go through you to put up there. Is there some other way that it could be kind of simplified?
Absolutely. Because there are lots of ways that it could be simplified. And this part of the conversation is about what we can do for the release of 5.1.10, that's all. So there's lots of other things that we could do in the future, but this is, let's fix the big problems for 5.1.10 with the existing mechanism, because I've got to get the thing out of the door as quickly as possible, and I will get it. I mean, I'll push it out of the door even if the community links are not up to date, but it just seems, you know, and all of us here, we've spent endless time talking about how important and valuable the community resources are. So I think it would be really great to nail that. And I'm sure it's not even that difficult, because although it feels like there's a lot of stuff out there, it's only a couple of dozen links or something, I should imagine.
could there be a form, like on my site Twaddle, there is a feedback form where people can post things.
There is already it goes back to, until we have an automated build process that allows people's submissions to be processed automatically, people's submissions can actually be made you can make a ticket on GitHub, you can send a message on the group, and that's fine. I mean, I'll always ask for a pull request as the preferred way of doing it, but I value all, feedback, actionable feedback like that. Jeremy, you're not linking to this site. That's great feedback, because I can just do that.
The problem here is that, for instance, GitHub, obviously very few, a small proportion of the community, as far as we know, or as far as I can tell, is using that. That's one thing. Just the second thing is, you're saying here and now, anyone can post, I'm hearing my own voice here echoing, and I...
Somebody else might need to mute.
Anyone can post on the board, and you will see it. But the problem is that if they don't hear you now saying this, then they don't know. So
absolutely.
People
that I think there's two very separate discussions here. One is this very near term thing, which feels like I'm rejecting the points that you're raising, because I'm saying the short term task is get 5.1.10 out the door with the infrastructure that we've got. Then beyond that, there's what are we going to do to make it easier for people to contribute? Okay. Actually, I think news.tiddlywiki.com is by far the most important thing, because that is it can function as a genuine forum, a peer-to-peer forum, whereas people sending edits to tiddlywiki.com is a collaborative editing process, and it's always going to be more work for the participants, for people. Obviously, contributing links is a very special kind of contribution, because it doesn't take much. Jeremy, please add this link. In general, to make improvements to the TiddlyWiki documentation, unfortunately, and I've now discovered this is common with most open source projects, it requires quite a lot of knowledge of how the project is documented, how the documentation is structured, where the links need to be for people to find some topic, that kind of thing. So there's a lot of barriers to making a decent contribution to the documentation. So I really want to get to the place where we'll hopefully always be blessed with people who are good at writing and documentation. So we want to channel them at writing and documentation. But for people who aren't thinking about it as, I want to improve the documentation, we want to give them a much freer, low-friction forum approach. So the things that are happening, first thing is Erwin's aggregator, and it's very much, he's doing, using a slightly different set of technology than I would, the thing that we've talked about before endlessly, harvesting a whole bunch of TiddlyWikis, cutting the tiddlers open, doing stuff to them, and he's, by doing it with different technologies, he's actually demonstrating, and one of the great things about TiddlyWiki is that format is so simple, it's trivial. Anybody can sit down in an evening and write a Python function, for instance, to split a TiddlyWiki file apart and to extract the tiddlers. For a programmer, it's a nice, easy task. So the aggregator is a really good step on all the federation stuff that we've talked about. And the aggregator basically aggregates, it's going to be, at the moment, Erwin's maintaining the list of sites that it aggregates. Ideally, people need to run their own aggregator, so they choose which sites they aggregate, they choose who to listen to, and we can get there too. But the other thing that I've mentioned briefly that I'm finally starting to pay attention to is using TiddlyWiki with Amazon's cloud APIs. So traditionally, the way to get TiddlyWiki running as a server has been to have a virtual server, to have a Linux box in the cloud onto which you install Node.js and so on. And services like Heroku are kind of simplified versions of that. What Amazon, well, what all of the cloud suppliers offer, but Amazon is an important case because they pretty much created this market, and so other people follow them, is much higher level cloud APIs, and particularly there's one called Lambda, Amazon Lambda. And what it is, extraordinarily, is a way to upload a blob of JavaScript to Amazon's cloud and specify a number of triggers that trigger its execution. And that code is, you're expected, it's a Lambda function, it's a stateless JavaScript function, which is an astonishingly good fit for the way that TiddlyWiki is structured. So what this line of work is, the goal of this line of work is me, again, picking up the goal of what we would all understand by a multi-user TiddlyWiki. A TiddlyWiki where multiple people can have accounts. When you edit a Tiddler, it's attributed to your username, and there is a change history against each Tiddler. So in other words, kinds of features that you're familiar with from Tiddly Space. And my the work and or exploration I've been doing so far suggests now that that's never been easier using these Amazon APIs. So they've got a storage service called DynamoDB, and it's a database API. When you use it, your stuff gets automatically replicated, so if there's an earthquake, blah, blah, blah. It's basically a Tiddler store because it stores JSON. So it's again, an astonishingly good fit for TiddlyWiki. So I'm hoping, again, Tiddly Desktop figures, what I would like to get to is the point where I've got a wiki on my desktop, a TiddlyWiki HTML file. Within Tiddly Desktop, I can right-click on it and say, make this into a wiki folder. Bang. Then it's been turned into a folder full of individual Tiddlers. Then I can say, specify a static subset of the content that I want to publish to GitHub pages. That's the blogging example. And then to be able to right-click and say push to Amazon, and then me having given it my Amazon credentials, it creates all the necessary gubbins in Amazon for you to have your personal multi-user TiddlyWiki. And then we'd use one of those as the community wiki. At the moment, people come up on the group from time to time, ask about multi-user use of TiddlyWiki, and our answers are poor. You know, there's not a good story. But a bit like I touched on with the capabilities that Dave has recently unleashed to produce those static renderings of individual Tiddlers, what's needed here is actually a pretty minor amount of work on top of what we've already got to build a great multi-user solution. And as I say, for me personally, I hate servers, I don't want to manage servers, I never want to be responsible for whether a server is secure or not. It just seems to me like a thankless task. And Amazon's approach frees me from all of that. And I think it's okay, as I say, because other cloud providers tend to copy Amazon's APIs, but also Amazon now have a pretty substantial free tier. So they're realizing, you know, Amazon's money in the future is from the widespread adoption of AWS. The way to do that is to make it as simple as possible for people to fall in love with AWS, Amazon Web Services, and become dependent upon it. So I think there's strong economic grounds that, you know, with cloud services being increasingly commodified, we're now getting to the point where, you know, just as PHP hosting was a kind of free commodity 10 years ago, it wasn't that hard to find free PHP hosting. And that was for strong economic reasons. Now, I think we will, in perpetuity, see Amazon offering this kind of free tier because their business model requires them to have an ingress of developers who are getting... Anyway, I'm going into far too much detail about that point. But that's where I want to go next, is TiddlyWiki in the sky for Amazon, as it would be called. And the goal is to make it... I'll be really personal about it. I want to make it so that Dave can set up a TiddlyWiki in the sky for his group of people. So one of the things that I can do with Amazon that's really cool is they have
integrated authentication for all the major authentication providers. So for me in my day job, we use something, we use Google Apps. So it means that you can, I can authenticate my users against Google and get back their email address for the company, and then I can use that to secure them. And all of that's without writing any Google-specific code. And it doesn't have to be Google. It can be, I don't know, Facebook, LinkedIn, all the other identity providers that are out there. So again, picking up something we said earlier, the most exciting things that happen in TiddlyWiki, we combine multiple things. One of the consequences of making a decent move to Amazon is the opportunity to combine with many, many more things. You know, the Internet of Things, Amazon is invests in that. They make it ridiculously easy to have a really cheap device, you know, a Raspberry Pi equivalent, monitoring data and logging it to Amazon securely so that it gets backed up, and creating a TiddlyWiki that's a perpetually up-to-date dashboard of that data, that kind of thing. You know, it's always really hard to get that done when we're constrained to running in the browser. But if you can see what I'm seeing in terms of a smooth transition from the world of working on my own machine via Tiddly Desktop, hiding some of the details, smoothly moving up to deploying stuff to Amazon, and what I'm describing is basically the working practices of software developers today. It's very conventional working. But again, trying to bring to ordinary users who are not software developers some of the capabilities that are normally restricted to them. So I've missed a whole load of comments inside. And let me just catch up. Nathan's saying, multi-user TiddlyWiki. I recently had a client evaluating wikis for storing developer onboarding knowledge, great application. I proposed TiddlyWiki, but they dismissed it outright for a very silly reason, because it is described on the site as a personal wiki, so they didn't even make it past the subtitle before rejecting it as an option. Yeah, I can imagine. I mean, of course, the thing, what most people in, you know, in work do is they, there's this backwards causality thing, they copy other people. Yeah, it's where TiddlyWiki sits at the moment. Asking people to consider it for a multi-user scenario is not for the faint-hearted. So I'm so sorry. I must drop off the call. Before we close, I just wanted to ask if anybody had any closing comments or thoughts.
If I get this into a state that's actually presentable, I think that I might just make a short video of it instead of keep trying to put it on
here. Please do. I think Felix would emphasize this as well, that making screencasts, people absolutely thank you for it. I'm terrible at it. My screencasts are very out of date. But it's still, it seems to be the most useful thing you can do for a lot of people to make it easy for them to assimilate your work. So yes, I'd love to see you do that. Anybody else? Okay, so I'm going to
an idea could otherwise be for Jed to demo his thing now without your presence, as we've done before.
I was going to say, I encourage you to carry on. I am going to stop the broadcast, and that's only because I feel that I'm the responsible one for the broadcast part. But even when I stop the broadcast, you can continue the discussion. And Jed, we'll, if you keep producing new stuff at the current rate of progress, we'll have a What's Jed Up To session every week. So the next Hangout is scheduled, I think, for next Tuesday. I'm pretty sure it's scheduled for next Tuesday. And then I've got to lay out the timetable for the next few weeks, which I will do. So it remains to say thank you very much to all of you for joining me today. Immensely appreciate your time and contribution. I hope that you found it useful. I always find it incredibly exhilarating and interesting. So, as I said, really thank you for making the time for it. And so let's close how we always do and wave at everybody and say goodbye whilst I press the stop broadcast button, and I'll see you on the other side. So thank you, everybody. Bye-bye. Cheers.